Ivory Hopkins, amen. I bring greetings to you all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I am so excited, amen, to be online talking to y'all today. We're trusting, amen, that this video be a blessing to you guys, amen. It always excites me at seeing how the Lord is reaching many of you, amen. So we give God the praise and the glory for His Holy Spirit being in the midst of our lives. Now, today I have got a message, amen, that I want to share with you, wonderful people of God. The title of the message is The Spiritual and Natural Consequences of Who You Bring Into Your Life in a Relationship or in a Marriage. Most of y'all who know me, amen, know, glory be to God, that my main forte is I was called to the deliverance ministry, and I thank God for that calling. That is what He's called me into. I'm also, amen, I counsel, amen, almost every week I counsel, amen, on many different subjects. And today I'm going to talk to y'all about, amen, the spiritual and natural consequences of who you bring into your life in a relationship. This message explains why you have to be careful with who you bring into your life, or it can be used to fight against your calling and your creativity. Good morning, Apostle George Pearson. How are you doing, Deborah Vale's daughter? I love you. Michelle Brown, God bless you. How you doing, Bree? Good to see you guys. Well, look, this morning I just want to, amen, enlighten some of the people out there to how to navigate in a relationship. Now, some of us, glory be to God, may have to consider that the reason why certain creativity in our life and certain giftings in our life are held up, delayed, or sometimes even killed out by a dream killer that you're dating, or a dream killer that you're in a relationship, or even, hate to say it, even marriage. The Apostle Paul says something in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and I'm going to read 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 6 through 9, and I'm also going to read verses 32 and 33 as I start launching this subject. Now, let me tell you what calls me to minister this message. Most of you know I've been in ministry now for over 45 years, been in deliverance ministry just about that long. Amen. And from time to time, I would meet people who would have marriages or date someone that by the time they hooked up with this particular individual, their spiritual life went down. Their prayer life, their drive, their fervor in God, even their creativity. And this can happen not only in ministry, it can also happen in just natural life and entrepreneurship. Well, I have met these type of people, and in praying and ministering to them, I said to them, I said, when did things start in your life feel like starting to dry up, where you lost your drive and your fervor and your desire to even do certain passions that you used to have? And they had to admit that it happened to them after they got in a relationship with certain people or a certain person. Let me tell y'all something. There is spiritual consequences and ramifications when you bring into your life certain people in a relationship or even a marriage. Almost 90% of them who have married this individual says these exact words to me. The Lord showed me not to marry them. The Lord showed me not to get in a relationship, and I pushed it aside and did it anyway. Now, I'm going to put this up front because I teach what I call balanced deliverance and balanced teaching. This is not a message where I'm trying to encourage somebody to run out and get a divorce. Look, if you're dealing with that type of thing, there's more to it than just running out, leaving, or divorcing someone. But I have seen this situation cause an individual to end up breaking up, separating, and some have even divorced. Why don't we tell the truth and shame three devils? This happens in many of our lives. Many of you have to understand, people of God, the calling and the purpose and the destiny in your life is extremely valuable. And the enemy of our soul will use anything he can to get us off track. And that's mainly what I'm talking about. You listening at me right now may very well be dating someone right now that ever since you started dating them, you compromised your values. You compromise your morals. You found yourself losing yourself. Let me begin to read here in the book of 1 Corinthians, as I said earlier. Now, here goes Paul saying this, but I speak this by permission and not of commandment. So Paul is basically saying, I have apostolic authority to say what I'm saying, but it is not a commandment from God, in the sense that Paul is saying this is not written right now in any biblical sense, but I'm giving spiritual wisdom by permission and insight. See, but I speak this by permission and not commandment. For I would that all men were even as I myself. Paul was not married. Paul was not dating. But he said every man, and when he says man here, he's talking about human being, not just a male. Every man have his proper gift of God. One after this manner and another after that. I say, therefore, to the unmarried and the widow, it is good for them if they abide even as I. So he's saying to the unmarried and widow, it would be good if you abided even like I am. Paul is saying, I'm not married. I have no obligation, no commitment to the marriage situation or the relationship situation. Are y'all hearing me? But Paul says everyone have their proper gift. Now, this is not a Bible verse saying that if you're single, praise God, you're supposed to just have Jesus and not have a relationship. That's not what Paul was saying. What Paul was saying in this particular example here, he says that as a person who does not have a relationship or a marriage with any of the opposite sex, I am totally have my attention committed to the Lord. And some of you that are listening at me, you went through a period in your life, and it's nothing wrong with desiring to be married, nothing wrong with desiring to date and be in a relationship. I said it. But I will say this to you. Like Paul, there were periods in your life where your concentration and dedication was solely to the Lord. Now look, I will say this to you. I am a married man. I've been married now for 31 years. And there is a commitment. Now, I'm committed to God. And I also have a commitment to Evelyn. Although it looks like, Brother Hopkins, you're just soaring and moving in the ministry. In 31 years of marriage, I have never taken a preaching engagement across the country or anywhere else without consulting with my wife, Evelyn, on the necessity of me being home as a husband, dealing with husband and wife and family duties. Are you hearing me? Now, Evelyn did not command me. Evelyn's not Jesus. I never put my wife Evelyn above the Lord. But I knew being married that I did not have the freedom to make decisions without answering to anyone at all. And thank God, Evelyn was the kind of woman that when she came into my life, Evelyn added to it. Do you know, guys, in 31 years of marriage, I have never had Evelyn do anything, including embarrass me. Now, there have been times Evelyn could have pulled me aside and have a come to Jesus meeting with me. But I have never had her do that in such a way to castrate me, if you get my drift, to come make me feel less than the man of God that I am. And believe you me, there have been times in the comfort of our bed, in the bedroom, and in the comfort of our kitchen, she has told me, Ivory, blank, 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 and blank, and this is how I feel about such and such. But that is completely normal. But she's never minimized me, embarrassed me, or killed my dreams. Are you hearing me? So therefore, like when Apostle Paul said that he would that others were like him, Paul was not married. Paul did not have to answer to an Evelyn or an Eveline or anybody else in marriage. And he said, I speak unto the widows and whatnot, if you, and what have you. It is good for them to abide even as I am to the widows and the singles. But he goes a little further in verse 9, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 9. But if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better to marry than to burn. Now, Paul was not saying, listen, get married just for sex. Everybody worth their salt knows that word burn means to burn with the passion of wanting to have sexual relationship. But listen, marriage is not sexual relationship solution. If you got a stronghold in the area of lust, getting married doesn't drive it away. Is anybody hearing me? But Paul was saying it's better to burn, it's better to be married than to burn or have that passion or have that drive, which Paul said, I don't have that. Paul was saying, I have found a place in my life where I don't need emotionally, physically, or sexually a mate, and bless Paul's heart. I'm not the chosen one for that game. But nonetheless, he was speaking by permission. Listen what it says in verse 32 and 33. But I would have you without carefulness, he that is unmarried careth for the things that belong to the Lord, how he may please the Lord. So he's saying, you that are unmarried, and he was speaking this, you don't have on you the obligation of a wife or a husband, which causes sometimes the feelings that you feel led to do, even led to do of the Lord, will not violate the principle of answering to your mate. But he that is married careth for the things that are of the world, how he may please his wife. Now let me get to the meat of what I'm going to say, because I'll soon have to get up out of here. As y'all know, I do counseling and deliverance all day long throughout the day. We do that, but this is a part. And I say this to some of you here. If you can learn from these YouTube videos and get an answer or a breakthrough from these YouTube videos, God bless you. Amen. May the purpose of me teaching this then has been done. Amen. But let me go ahead and get to the meat of what I was talking about today. I have found in some people's lives that the problem that they have spiritually in their lives is the person that they've gotten contact with. I'm talking about the spiritual and the natural consequences of who you bring into your life in a relationship or a marriage. There are some people that were flowing in God, and the enemy sent someone that was not a legitimate mate. Listen to what I'm saying. The enemy sent you someone that was going to carry you into a date to nowhere. Ever since you got with them, there was no commitment, but there was a whole lot of compromising of what you believe and stand for. That type of person, I'm going to describe the dangers of when you have gotten in that situation. Now, if you are married already in that situation, the answer to your situation is to pray and ask God how to help you navigate through it. Because sometimes when you have made that situation and the person in your life is going to do some of the things that I'm naming here, the Lord will show you how to remain strong and faithful in an imperfect marriage. Such as Abigail had an imperfect marriage. Nabal was a piece of work to live with. Even Nabal's servants said, we know that our master is such a son of Belial. Now that word son of Belial means our master is such a worthless man, can't nobody tell him nothing. Now could you imagine what it must have been like, Abigail being married to this man? But it was her husband, and Abigail did not divorce him, and Abigail did not run out on him. Oh, y'all hearing me what I'm saying? But Abigail was in a position with a man that was narcissistic, that you couldn't tell anything. And here he was, the head of that house, a very rich entrepreneur, but very ignorant. Are you hearing me? And sometimes, and I'm being real, real nice. Now, to some of you in deliverance, if you wonder why I just don't do the demon stuff, it's because I have found by wisdom for the calling that I have, to expose the root cause why spirits are operating in people's lives. And I maintain to tell you, in this particular teaching, I'm trying to warn some of you that are single, in relationships, or thinking about one, to be very careful of bringing someone in your life that they are not biblically based, they are not sound in the word or serving the Lord, they do not embrace your faith. Be very careful of being unequally yoked to an unbeliever. That includes one that claims they have Christ, but yet their whole other attitude doesn't match the Christian or the word. And when I speak of the word Christianity, believe you me, I'm not talking about some of the foolishness that we're seeing on TV running around here today. And I'm not talking about Christian TV shows. I'm talking about the dynamics of the fool. I'm talking about godly principles that are following the biblical teachings of Christ, the kingdom. Now, I'm going to move past that because I can preach a whole sermon on that subject alone. So this message today is to give you all some telltale signs, some ways of understanding when you have brought in your life, or you're in a relationship or dating or considering marriage. Number one, the characteristics that I have found in these people who have brought the wrong spiritual person in their life, and it costs the anointing to change. It costs their creativity to change. It costs their hopes and desires to change. Here goes some of the characteristics. Number one, while dating them, you have a feeling, a deep feeling inside that something is not right. Now, you love the way they look. Matter of fact, you even lust the way they look. Get what I'm saying? In other words, they got the package that you like to jump on. But by you being saved, you may not have jumped on the package, but you forget what's in the content. In other words, your eyes see what it wants, but it doesn't necessarily mean it's good for you. Got that? I will say this, and Evelyn knows this because she knows just about everything about me you can ever know. Amen. It was never my intent to marry out of my race. It was. Now, did you get that? I never intended to marry out of my race. Now, this goes way back in my life before Christ. But when God brought Evelyn in my life, she fit every criteria of the kind of woman I was wanting in my life, but I had to struggle with, but she's not of my culture. And now you got to understand, you're talking way back there years ago. You're talking 41 years ago and what have you. Are you following me? But Evelyn was the best thing that ever came in my life. She celebrated me. She built my life up. It wasn't about her skin. It wasn't about her race. It was because she was the chosen one for me. Evelyn was compatible spiritually, compatible. And in the natural, she was compatible when I began to say, God, I want the woman that you sent my way. And 41 years later, and some of you soldiers know who Evelyn is, and I'm telling you, hey, Kevin Bailey, you know Ab is awesome, ain't she? She is a good woman. My God, she is a blessing. But I'm going to tell you, my natural mind was not looking for her. It was looking for a sister of a certain type. Now, and by the way, to my wonderful, beautiful black women out there, you are awesome. Y'all are magnificent. This isn't no black brother that was upset with a black woman and got myself a white wife. You girls are awesome. You women are awesome. Matter of fact, I have two great all black women in my life. My daughter Jackie and my mama, most powerful. And I ain't about to say how awesome my sisters are. Hey, sis, hey, this ain't your brother saying this because y'all are listening at me, y'all. But Shirley, Mary, Dolores, y'all are awesome. Stephanie, Lavola, and Regina, y'all are some awesome black women. But let me move on. I done said that. But my point was, sometimes what you're looking for is not what God is giving you. And you got to be willing to let go what you're looking for to find out what God has really sent you. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? But one of the telltale signs is you want it so bad that you neglect the signs that you're seeing that something is wrong. You want to be with them so bad, you put away what you're seeing. Number two, others who know you know that ever since you've been with them, you're not the same. And if you get a hold of them when you have a calling on your life, if you bring them in your life and you are moving in the gospel, moving in ministry, moving in business, moving in entrepreneurship, that person in your life will start putting demands on you that draw you away from your passion. So that goes to number two. Do they celebrate you? Are you hearing me? You can't afford to neglect what you see. Do they celebrate you? Or do you always have to minimize yourself to make them happy? Because in a case like that, that's exactly what your marriage will be. It will be a marriage where you're constantly trying to stroke their ego with no risk, no payback, no give back to you for what you desire. I never will forget when Evelyn and I got married in the earlier years. One day Evelyn said to me, we were both working in the state of Delaware and what have you, doing fairly well. And Evelyn said to me, she said, I want to go back to college. I would like to get a degree in business. And I turned around and said to her, I said, oh, that's great. She said, honey, you do realize, Aubrey, that it means that two nights a week, I won't be home until later in the evening. I said, Ev, if that's what you want, that's what we do. Now, at that particular time, now I'm going to tell y'all this. My entrepreneur work was, Evelyn was a Tupperware manager. She joined Tupperware. I worked for the state of Delaware on a food truck delivering food. At that particular time, I was no longer working as an attendant. The money that we made selling Tupperware. Now, why did I say I worked on a truck? Because I had the ability to go to every cottage in that particular environment. We had 500 employees there at that hospital. And I was able to take Tupperware books out there, and through Tupperware sales, it helped me and Evelyn be able to pay for her to go to college, and Evelyn ended up getting a degree, a business degree. Matter of fact, that same business degree that blessed us and still helping us to this day. This is why our life and our finances are so organized. But here goes the clincher. When Evelyn was a kid, she was told when she was a teenager that why you want to go to college? What are you trying to be all sadiddy? What are you trying to be all big time? And so it crushed her spirit. This person that spoke that in Evelyn's life, she loved them, she cared about them, but they killed the dream in her. And then she marries old Ive. She marries her husband here. And when she said she wanted to do that, all I wanted to do was to see her. I wouldn't have cared if she tried and failed. I wanted at least to support her trying. But not only did she try, she did not fail, and it has caused us economically to have our finances in order on all levels, home, church, and personal life. Everybody with me? Now, so the person in your life, if they are the chosen one, besides knowing God, besides embracing your faith, and that's another one. If they fight you on your faith, in order to have them in your life, you have to minimize what God has in you. Now, there is a place where one has to say, well, look, I've had people ask me, well, look, Brother Hopkins, can you do a conference for us? And I've told a person one time, no, I'm unable to do it. I'm going to share this to you, and I know y'all might look at this funny, but I'm going to share it. I never will forget Kevin, Apostle Kevin, you're going to like this. Apostle Kevin, you my boy. You know that, brother. I love you. Man, you're on there this morning. Listen to me. Listen to this, Apostle Kevin. One of my sons had asked me to preach on a particular Friday night. He had asked that maybe 4 or 5 months before this particular thing came up. Now, I'm going to say this to you. So, now listen at what I'm saying. And some of you may criticize it, but there is a reason I did it. Evelyn loved the Four Tops' music. She loved listening at the Four Tops. Are you hearing me? So I called my spiritual son and I said to him, listen, I found out, I called him a couple of months ahead. I said, I found out that in Atlantic City, there's a show where the Four Tops will be singing, and they're pretty old now, and I'm hoping to bless Evelyn to hear the originals sing. I said, so what I want to do? And he said, oh, he said, look, we can rebook that. We rebooked the service. And it's up for me to come that Friday night. We rebooked it. And I said, now what I'm going to do, Anthony, Apostle Anthony, I am going to put some clothes in the car. I'm going to pack them up. And we're going to leave out just like we're heading to where we're supposed to be coming to you. Well, Evelyn had no idea. Now, she's all ready. She's got her church clothes on. She's ready to go. And she says to me, Audrey, you're going the wrong way. I said, no, babe, I'm not going the wrong way. I said, just ride and enjoy the scenery. She said, you're supposed to be doing the service. It's in Seaford. What are you doing? Where are you going? I drove and I just laughed and played with her. And I drove and I said to her when we got to the place where the show was going to be at, I said, Evelyn, the Four Tops are playing here. I brought front row seats for us to take you in and for you to enjoy the Four Tops. I said, Apostle Anthony and I changed the date. And I'm taking you, baby, to hear the Four Tops. Now, y'all get this. Now, like I said, I know some of y'all might be so spiritual you can't hear the Four Tops, but God bless you. And guess what? Stubbs came down off the stage, walked up to Evelyn, and he began to sing to my wife. I mean, if you could have seen the look on her face, she was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. She said, you did this for me. Listen, let me tell you something. It may not be the Four Tops. It may not be something like that. But if anybody cares anything about you, they will go out of their way. And sometimes, listen, I talk to some people, you're so caught up in ministry. You're so caught up in so-called doing for the Lord that you have no natural life. That also can be a danger. That also can be a damage to the marriage. On the one side, having a person that doesn't celebrate your calling, doesn't support your calling is a problem, doesn't support your vision, your dream, or your creativity is a problem, and having a person that is so doggone religious till they can't do nothing and even enjoy yourselves, that person is equally a problem. In my marriage, in my life, like my teaching, I have what I call balance. I have date time with my Evelyn. Yesterday, I took my wife out on a date. Now, I live in an area called Rehoboth Beach, Delaware. Very nice area. I took her out on a date. Why? Because all day long, I had been working and counseling with people, and all I took her out was for a small lunch date that was all about her. The right person in your life will know how to do things that's all about you. Another sign, another danger sign in a relationship or even in a marriage, when you find that person jealous and competitive with the calling that's in you. What, hey, Kevin, listen to that, Brother Pastor Kevin. I once watched a married team, a husband and wife in the ministry. Listen to this, Kevin. In the ministry, I once watched a husband and wife that were, it was crazy. The husband was jealous of the wife's calling. He was jealous of the anointing that was in the woman he loved. Now, how in the world would I become jealous of what's in my own body? Now, what do I mean by that? The two shall be made one. But I have met ministry, male and female, do this stuff. One being competitive or jealous of the other. That is ridiculous. But I have seen that spirit. And it usually be something like, the person should have dealt with that with their lives. They should have dealt with that with grace. But instead, they become competitive. Some of you are in relationship. That person you're dating is competitive. They're jealous. And they, listen, they don't care about your passion. And that's the same way they will be if you marry them. They will not care about what your concern is. Got that? Their thoughts would be very narcissistic. And a male or female can be narcissistic, can be selfish. Are you hearing me what I'm saying to you? And sometimes I have met this type of thing. If you had caught it when the Lord tried to show you they're not the chosen one, I want to tell you there is nothing wrong with dating and finding out they're not the chosen one. Are you hearing me? Now, I know we in church like to play this game. We always hear from the Lord, lie. We always know what our direction and path, lie. Why don't you just tell the truth and shame the devil? Sometimes you have been in a relationship with someone that was not the chosen one. Or you've been in a relationship with someone that it is better for you to get out of the relationship rather than to stay in it and live miserably. I'm talking about you see the telltale signs. Apostle Kevin, somebody that's listening at this right now, well, probably is going to have to make up your mind, should I stay or should I go? Is you hearing me? Because that person will fight the anointing in your life. They will fight the vision in your life. They will fight the grace that's in your life. Please hear me, people of God. Stop pretending that we're always led and know what we're doing. If it's not working, if it's not matching up, call it what it is and let it go. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You're constantly arguing all the time. You're arguing all the time on who you are. You're happy. Listen, when I married Evelyn, I married Evelyn. She is not act like some other sister or some other woman. She is Evelyn, and I stay away from comparing. I talked to a person one time, not too long ago, the young man that she was considering marrying was made a pass with in a restaurant with a waitress almost in her face. Now, if that joker makes a pass in your face with someone in that restaurant, that's who he is. That's who he is. If he or she does things to violate the commitment y'all are trying to create, that is who they are. Are you hearing me? I'm like Maya Angelou. When people show you who they really are, believe them the first time. Are you hearing what I'm saying? If that person is completely controlling and manipulating, in other words, glory be to God, they have no consideration for you. Everything is all about them. Matter of fact, the demands that they put on you in the relationship has you starting to not be you, then guess what? You might have got a person that is not the chosen one. I'm going to say something to some of you, and I know you might say, well, Brother Ivy, you're saying that because you've been married so long. Listen, it's better to be single and seeking the chosen one than to be single and let the wrong one be your choice. Because if you let the wrong one be your choice, that's what you will be living with, doing warfare with, and having heavy mental oppression with. The enemy will send people in your life that are not the chosen one. Now, I know we don't hear this preached very often, but I say this to you. My style of deliverance teaching is putting meat on the people's bones in the Bible, putting straight up truth. I talk about subjects that people don't talk about because, once again, you did not get these demons by the demons jumping on you, making you do stuff. You open yourself up to strongholds that were able to get in because of the ground that we give them. Don't let rejection and insecurity and fear of never having anybody cause you to settle for the wrong person. Do you know what? I often talk to people and they say to me, well, the person that I was seeing, they were abusive and they talked verbally to me bad. I said, okay. They were harsh with their words. I said, okay. And they didn't care about my thoughts and it was all about them. I said, okay. And even they ran out on me. I said, okay. And they said, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with me that this happened? I said, what do you mean what's wrong with you? Well, Brother Ivory, something must be wrong with me. I said, why? Because some of the people I seem to date seem to be that way. I said, let me work with your girlfriend. You're telling Brother Ivory that you dated a person to find out if they were the chosen one. Yes. And you found out they were controlling, they were manipulative, they weren't faithful, they would not commit. Yes. And the problem is you. Well, it must be. I said, sister girl, the problem is not you. Please don't beat yourself up because you had enough revelation and enough insight to find out who not to be with. In short, listen, when Evelyn married me, Evelyn has always been faithful to me. If I start being unfaithful to her, Evelyn did not break any vows. Evelyn did not make a bad choice. I made bad choices. Listen, in other words, stop making yourself, amen, the enemy or the one that must be bound up because the other bound up person does something. What has happened is, and I tell the people I counsel this, it's not that you are bound or cursed. You just had enough wisdom to find out what not to attach your life to. Instead of feeling like you are cursed, you ought to drop confetti and have a parade. Hallelujah, drop confetti and have a parade because you found out what they really were before you sealed the deal and married them. Is everybody hearing me? And so I say to you, let me move on. So do they lock down your creativity? Ever since you was dating them, has your prayer life stopped? Have your study, your relationship, your intimacy with God, has it stopped? Do you know that all the years I've been married with Evelyn, there is an intimacy and a secret place with God that Evelyn knows that I have that she will never get in? She will never be able to fit in there, and neither will I be able to fit in hers. I can pray along with Evelyn in prayer. Me and Evelyn, matter of fact, this morning, me and Evelyn are going to have communion together in the house here. We're going to get our communion cups, and we're going to have communion together. But my communion with God, my intimacy with God, my relationship in prayer with God alone is mine and God's alone. Evelyn is not a part of that. Now, that's different than Evelyn being a part of us praying together as a husband and wife. There's an intimacy with God that Evelyn has that I will never fit in. There are things a part of Evelyn's walk. There's things a part of Evelyn's passion and her dreams and hopes. The only thing I can do with them is support her in them, not kill her. Some people, you have mates, and I'm talking about married couple. Your mate may not be perfect, but they don't fight you for being who you are. That person can be the chosen one. Their spiritual growth in that sense is not wrong, neither is it your place to try to be God to make them you. Are you hearing me? Be careful of that danger too. Yeah, you can have people in your life, yes ma'am, that are not on the same spiritual level. That's not a game changer. What is a game changer is when they're not only not on your spiritual level, but they try to kill you out in your walk. They always try to break your spirit. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? If they fill you with a lot of low self-esteem, and they don't emotionally connect with you, they make you starve for affection. Are you hearing me? That's an operation that the enemy does. They want to manipulate situations all the time. Everything is always going back and forth, arguing and fussing. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? Listen, my people, if you are dating a situation like this, you want to choose whether you want to continue in it or not. Now, that's what I'm saying to you. I'm going to say it again because pretty soon I'm going to have to get ready to get up out of here because like I told y'all, I have got to get ready to start my deliverance counseling and not only counsel, my counseling sessions and deliverance. But listen, as I'm getting ready to come to the conclusion of this message here, listen, be very, very careful of the spiritual and the natural consequences of who you bring into your life in a relationship or even in a marriage. Be very careful. It is better to break up with something that is not working, not chosen, not God, than to stay with it and marry it and end up either or living a full life in that bondage or ending up with a separation and divorce. Now, let me say this to someone who said, well, Brother Ivory, thanks for the message, but it's too late, long gone. If you are married in a situation like that, you're in a situation like Abigail. Abigail was a faithful wife. I say some of us will be faithful brothers, faithful husbands. Amen. I like to try to meet this thing out because I don't believe in that mess like the woman is under anybody's foot because the woman ain't under nobody's foot. My wife ain't under nobody's foot and ain't nobody Evelyn's putting their foot on Evelyn, me or nobody else. Ain't happening. Not on my watch. But anyway, let me say this. If you're in a situation like that and you realize, you say, you know what, I am married. It's enough has not been done for any divorce or anything like that. That in a case like that, what you want to do is ask the Lord to give you both the spiritual strength and the spiritual wisdom, how to disconnect from narcissism, how to disconnect. Now, listen, it is possible in even a rough situation like that to look at your mate and know you need deliverance. She needs deliverance. But in the process of time, you're holding your own prayer life, worship, creativity. You're having to guard it and not let their negative demon bind it up in you. There are people living this every day. Yeah, I'm gonna say it. And what have you? How do you disconnect from a narcissistic? Good question. If you can define what a narcissist is, then you can stop yielding to it when it comes at you. Are you hearing what I'm saying to you? In other words, you will stop having yourself committing your hopes and dreams on a bound up attitude. Are you hearing me? Some people are married to people that are controlling. And to a degree, you can pull back from some of their control to a degree. There are some things that, hey, it is a part of what you're dealing with, and there's great that God's grace is sufficient. It's not going to be ideal. But I'm going to say this. Listen to this, Atara. When you are in a relationship that you've married into it, and it has got some narcissism in it, in other words, when you recognize that coming at you and what have you, stop giving it response. Listen, and don't go off with that stuff like, Lord, I don't know why you put me in this. Because let me help you. Jesus, the Lord, did not put you in that. It was a decision that you made, seeing the things early that you did not deal with. Now, yes, is there ever anybody that acts one way dating and another way when you get married? I believe it so. I do. I don't believe everyone shows who they are before you end up marrying them. There are some people that you may be dating, they're acting one way, and after you married them, they came up with a whole new game. In a situation like that, when you recognize what spirit is coming at you in that marriage, you not only pray against it, you not only bind against it, you start looking at ways of not letting that thing control your spiritual and natural life. In other words, and I'm going to tell you this, please never put all of your hope in someone bound changing. Learn how to find, to be keep who you are, how to keep true to your values, how to keep true to your dreams despite them. It's done every day. In other words, for me to be free, I don't need everybody agreeing with me. For me to be free, I don't need you not to reject me. I need to learn how to disengage, needing your approval for me to exist. And some marriages have this in it. Are you hearing me? Now, I am not about to sit here and own this here and start telling you, divorce them. That's not my call. That is not my call. But I will tell you this, if you are living in a situation like this, and you say, good Lord, this man is preaching what I have been experiencing. The Holy Spirit and sound wisdom will show you how to start saving yourself. Something my aunt said to me, and when I say saving yourself, you're going to get it. Something my aunt said to me years ago, she said, Ivory, and this was my auntie that raised me in Princess Anne, Maryland. Her name was Nene Boomer. My aunt one day sat me down, and I was about 15 years old. And she knew I had this large heart that some of y'all even have seen. I've always had a big heart for people in life. I always would overextend myself. I always would give myself. But sometimes I would deal with people that were living on different rules than mine. And one day my auntie said to me, she said, Ivory baby, I'm gonna tell you something, son. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, Ivory, she said, you got a big heart, son. She said, but save a little bit of yourself for you. And I looked at her at 15. I was like, what is she saying? You got a big heart, but save a little bit of yourself for you. What the world was my aunt saying? Why did she say that? And down at 65 years old, down through the years in my life, I have seen the damage when I gave all of myself away to anyone. I always save a piece of myself for me. What part is that? That piece of myself for me is I still gonna be true to my dreams. I still gonna be true to my God. I'm still gonna be true to my morals. I gotta keep a piece of myself for me. Now, all of you listening to me, including some of you that are married, how you doing, Angie Dean? I love you, Angie. I love you and Ricky Dean. You know I love you immensely, you guys. Amen. Those are part of my posse. That's my soldier there. But no matter, even if you're married, there has to be a piece, a part of you that you have to save for you. And that's the part of your dreams. That's the part of your hopes. That's the part of your own thoughts and your own ideas. That is a part of what makes you who you are. If Evelyn, for 41 years, diminished who I am, she would not have been the chosen one for my life. If I had to marry Evelyn and no longer be Ivory, and she had to marry Ivory and no longer be Evelyn, meaning Evelyn's thoughts, Evelyn's passions, Evelyn's, I agree with you, Evelyn's, I don't agree with you, then she's not the chosen one, and I would be more damaged to her than I am good. People, as I get ready to close, be careful, you that are dating, you that are seeking marriage, be careful of bringing into your life someone that doesn't celebrate who you are. If you have to diminish who you are to have them, something is wrong with that picture. Well, guys, this has been the message, the spiritual and natural consequences of who you bring into your relationship or marriage. Well, guys, remember what I always tell you. I want y'all to remember, God, He's watching. God bless.